Vincent van Gogh was on the verge of success and may have killed himself at the very moment he was going to become what he always wanted. Mental asylum outside San Ramon, Paris. It has spent just over a year. It was originally he'd go to a large public institution in Marseille with over 1,000 patients right in the heart of the city. If he had, there is no chance that he would have produced the extraordinary work he did. In a small asylum at Saint-Rémy with only 41 patients, Vincent would be treated with kindness and understanding. The doctors quickly realized that the only way Vincent could survive was if he was given the space and the freedom paint the world. Art will keep him alive. As other patients screamed through the night, Vincent's creativity and work ethic were stronger than ever. He spent every waking hour painting, and on the whole, producing mostly optimistic landscapes. He always worked extremely quickly, often finishing a painting in just a few hours. Incredibly, considering his circumstances, he finished at least 100 paintings during his stay at the asylum. That is about one painting. And it was on the 18th of June, 1889, that he painted The Starry Night. Vincent van Gogh is often seen as the archetypal mad-crazed artist, and although he did have extreme manic episodes, most of the time he was lucid and rational. Vincent was incredibly intelligent and well-read. He was so knowledgeable about art and artists. He was articulate and spoke four languages. He also had lifelong friends who he met or wrote to regularly, but he struggled particularly difficult period of living with Paul Gauguin, he suffered an attack of acute mania, culminating in hallucinations and hearing voices, which led to him cutting off his own ear. The doctors at the asylum diagnosed epilepsy. In all probability, he also had what today we call bipolar, with manic episodes and auditory hallucinations, as well as syphilis. He called his fellow patients his companions in misfortune. And recent discoveries show us that Vincent was probably the sanest patient at Saint-Rémy. Overall, the asylum had a positive effect on him, and he was well enough to paint about 75% of the time. One visitor, when he came to see Vincent, found him to be in perfect physical and mental health. And after he left the asylum, Vincent went to Paris to visit his brother Theo, whose wife Jo remarked on how healthy he looked. In the asylum, he was drinking a lot less, no absinthe, no complicated romances, and a regular isolation turned out to be good for him, and with no outside distractions, Vincent, always a hard worker, would channel all his energies into his work. When we think of 19th century asylums, we think of them as horrific institutions, but the founder of San Remi Asylum was a progressive who believed that being surrounded by nature was good for troubled brains, and had planted extensive gardens. He also believed in the healing power of art and music. Of course, it was not easy for Vincent, and he suffered manic attacks when he was unable to paint. But it could have been a lot worse. His brother Theo, who was paying for the treatment, insisted that the asylum allow Vincent to paint, and he was given a dedicated studio. His paintings are so often seen as a descent into madness, but his work drove him and energized him. He created these images despite his mental illness, not because of it. As Vincent was led into his sparse cell on the first day, he must have been terrified, but also reassured to find that, although his window had bars, the view was spectacular. Wheat fields glowed in the sun, with olive groves and vineyards receding into the distant foothills of a low mountain range called the Zalpin. Initially, he portrayed the world he saw from this room, the subject of many paintings at San Remi. But within weeks, he would be allowed to wander around the dramatic countryside alone. The morning after his arrival at the asylum, Vincent went into the ruled garden, set up his easel, and by lunchtime, painted this, the first of his asylum masterpieces. Vincent van Gogh was a largely self-taught artist who didn't pick up a paintbrush until he was 30 years old, and just 7 years later, he would be dead. It was really his last 4 years where he developed a style we would come to know him by, and these were also his most prolific years. Once he found his way, he was making up for lost time. Vincent's 2 years in Paris up until February 1888 are widely seen as laying the foundation for his later Renoir's career, exposing him to the influence of impressionists such as Monet and Picasso, but also a younger generation of artists, including Paul Signac, Emile Bernard, and Toulouse-Lautrec, who would all remain lifelong friends. Like many of that generation, he was influenced by Japanese prints, which, along with his Paris years, had a transformative effect on his work and laid the foundations for radical works like the style of art. We know for a fact that Vincent was an admirer of Opposite's The Great Wave, and here we can make comparisons not only
Japanese style.
For the final 5 years of his career, the bright new palette takes over from his previous dark muted colour scheme, a period that coincided with the invention of many new synthetic pigments that Vincent took advantage of. Colour, above all, was Vincent's visual vocabulary. With these later works, we see more and more Japanese influence. Blocks of pure colour, dark outlines, no shadows, unusual cropping and distorted perspective. This was just one of the many letters Vincent wrote to friends that mentioned the Starry Sky, and it was something he had planned for a while. The Starry Night depicts the view from his asylum window on the upper floor. He had already painted the view dozens of times, but this time it was a nocturne, which, as he couldn't paint in the dark, meant it was painted from memory during the day in his ground floor studio. The views he painted from his window are all linked by the diagonal line coming in from the right, depicting the low rolling hills. In reality, the cypress trees were much smaller and along the far wall, enclosing the wheat field. For Starry Night, Vincent brings the tree much closer to the picture plane. This reminds us of the tight cropping we see in Japanese prints. The cypress tree is a newly discovered motif for Vincent, and are seen as a symbol of death in Mediterranean culture. Here, the tree shoots up into the sky, linking heaven and earth. Like the Impressionists, Vincent had always insisted on existed then, but in the asylum of limited freedom, it was a necessity. In this highly charged picture, he would create and paint something we cannot see or touch, something immaterial. He would use paint to show a sky that is electric. It is how we imagine the night sky to be. This is a critical time for art, when artists are shifting from the narrative to expressing themselves with new ways of seeing. Vincent's work is paving the way for modern art. Is this an accurate depiction of the stars on or around Jupiter? Astronomers have worked out that the moon that night was actually almost full, rather than the present moon we see in the painting. And Venus, the brightest star, was only visible just before dawn, by which time the moon was not visible. On this recreation, you can see the constellation Aries is also visible. I think the starry night is an amalgamation of nighttime and game of years for us. The sky is painted with Vincent's signature short brushstrokes of thick impasto. We can see how he applies the impasto technique, painting so thickly, sometimes straight from the tube, spreading paint like butter with a palette. It is these paint-heavy stabbing brushstrokes that distinguish Vincent from the other post-impressionists. A few weeks before, Vincent, in a manic episode, had tried to poison himself by swallowing paint and turpentine, literally killing himself with colour. And now he was using the same tubes to produce this. Colour was Vincent's way of communicating, and he had an innate and even avant-garde tendency towards colours that were expressive and intense. He had learned about complementary colour theory after seeing paintings by artists like Rubens, and in particular Delacroix. In Paris, Vincent went to see the ceiling room at Delacroix in the north, and it was a revelation how bright contrast and colours could work together. Vincent read everything he could on Delacroix's colour theories, which uses opposite colours on the colour palette. Combination which gives high contrast and high impact. For example, red and green, or blue and orange. The impressionists in Paris gave him looser, lighter brushstrokes, and the pointillist Sauval introduced him to optical mixing, pure colours blended by the eye to form a coherent image. His brother Theo would later say that the starry night was style over substance. Just how stylized are Vincent's running galaxies? If we look at a modern image of a world or a galaxy, it bears a striking resemblance to Vincent's stars. Could he have known about spiral galaxies back in 1889? This drawing, made by the English astronomer Lord Rosse in 1850, was reproduced as an etching of a French astronomer, which had caused a sensation. Vincent, who was passionate about astronomy, even met the author in Paris. The white band hanging over the hills is almost certainly the morning mist. By the time he painted the starry night, he was allowed out to explore the area alone. And it was on one of these walks he drew this bird's eye view of the village. He places the village in the valley, even though it was not visible from Vincent's room or from the studio, who was in fact in the opposite direction. He shows a dozen or so houses, whereas there were in fact hundreds. He has the houses lit by possibly bright gas lamps as a device to balance out the yellow stars. Vincent paints an idealized village, but it bears no resemblance to the wood or even the dome church of Saint-Denis. The pitched roof he portrays is more reminiscent of the Dutch churches in Europe. I wonder if he was also thinking of the little childhood church in Newman, where his father was the preacher. Like all great paintings, the starry night has been interpreted in many ways, notably concerning his religious beliefs. Although Vincent became an evangelical preacher in his 20s, he later rejected Christianity. But when Vincent lost his faith, he transferred many of his ideas into his art. Hard work and the appreciation of nature were seen as part of the worship of God in the Protestant tradition in which he was raised. His art had always emphasized the changing and renewing power of the sentence. And there was no hard and working artist in any concept. In less than a decade, he created about 2,100 artworks, including around 860 oil paintings, most of which date from the last 2 years of his life. He spoke of art as a new kind of religion, a way to console people, and the Starry Night in particular reflected their beliefs. Nature for him was a source of the infinite, and the stars had a deep spiritual meaning. Stars must have comforted Vincent as he gazed at the night sky for himself. Vincent van Gogh would dismiss his most famous painting as a failure, and maybe if he lived longer, he would have painted over it, as he did with so many of his paintings he considered failures. He was released from the asylum and he moved to the village of Beauclair, 20 kilometers north of Paris. And 2 months later, he shot himself. It took Vincent 36 hours to die, which meant Theo, a brother who supported him, both financially and emotionally, was at his side when he died. Theo himself was to die just 6 months after Vincent. It is a myth that Vincent was unrecognized in his lifetime. He was already considered an important artist by his peers. His work had been shown in an exhibition in Brussels alongside Toulouse-Lautrec, Cézanne, and Renoir. The Red Vineyard was sold for the decent sum of 400.